Good morning. Buenos días. Muchísimas gracias por acompañarnos. Thank you very much for being here this morning and accompanying us. We are here today to talk about a very important issue for Latinas and for women in general regarding the Violence Against Women Act, VAWA. October is a Domestic Violence Awareness Month, and Mujeres Latinas en Acción, along with Casa de Esperanza, are releasing our seventh Latina portrait series called The Reauthorization of VAWA and Latinas. As we all know, domestic violence affects people of all races, ethnicities, religions, socioeconomic, and educational levels. Since VAWA's passage in 1994, reporting of domestic violence has increased as much as 51%. Incidents of domestic violence has been reduced by 53%. And the homicide rate for intimate partner violence has declined. Yet, much more work remains to be done. Studies show that 1 in 4 women will be a victim of domestic violence over the course of her lifetime, and on average, 3 women a day are killed as a result of domestic violence. Mujeres provides direct services and programs of victims of violence, and we are highly aware of the impact that this VAWA legislation has on many of our participants and their families. As an effort to raise awareness and end the violence, this month allows us to showcase our work and highlight the importance of this issue. It is because of national organizations like Casa de Esperanza in Minnesota, and local organizations like Mujeres Latinas en Acción, as well as work by community women from El Paso, Texas, that we can continue to stress the importance of programs that provide counseling and treatment for services of violence, as well as to provide policies that will protect women and families from abuse. For these reasons, this report is very relevant, since VAWA has been a critical piece of bipartisan legislation that has provided key protections for the most vulnerable. I'm going to do a quick summary of this in Spanish before we go on with the program. Como mencioné, buenos días. Estamos aquí para hablar sobre este tema tan importante para Latinas y para mujeres en general, que tiene que ver con la Acta de Violencia contra la Mujer, VAWA, por sus siglos en inglés. El mes de octubre es el mes de traer la información y ponernos de acuerdo de qué es el tema de violencia doméstica. Y Mujeres Latinas en Acción, acompañada con Casa de Esperanza, presentamos nuestra séptima Latina Portrait, que se llama La Reauthorización de VAWA y la Mujer Latina. Como saben, violencia doméstica afecta a personas de todas raíces, de todas razas, etnicidades, religiones, estatus económicos, niveles de educación. Pero desde que ha pasado el VAWA en 1994, reportaje de violencia doméstica ha incrementado como el 50%. Incidentes de violencia doméstica han sido reducidas por el 53%, y el homicidio de violencia doméstica con parejas íntimas ha bajado. Pero todavía sigue mucho que tiene que hacer. Estudios nos enseñan que 1 de cada 4 mujeres pueden ser víctimas de violencia doméstica. Y su curso de su vida puede ser que cada 3 mujeres al día, tomen en cuenta que cada 3 mujeres al día mueren por el resultado de violencia doméstica. Mujeres provee servicios directos y programas para víctimas de violencia doméstica, y sabemos la importancia y el impacto que tiene que ver con esta legislación de VAWA. Y sabemos que los participantes y nuestras familias necesitan esta reauthorización. Con este esfuerzo que tenemos, vamos a hablar sobre este importante tema y lo importante que es y por qué y el cual, por la razón, organizaciones nacionales como Casa de Esperanza en Minnesota, como organizaciones locales como Mujeres Latinas en Acción, Mujeres Trabajando Comunitarias en El Paso, Texas, siguen reforzando la importancia de programas que incluye consejería y trato sobre para las sobrevivientes de violencia. Así que necesitamos que seguir mejorando estas pólizas para proteger a nuestras mujeres y familias del abuso. Por estas razones, este reporte es tan relevante y tan importante, y VAWA sigue siendo una pieza crítica con legislación que sea bipartisanista, o sea, con los dos partidos. Estas protecciones se tienen que proteger a los más vulnerables. Hoy vamos a hablar un poco sobre la historia de VAWA y cómo la violencia doméstica afecta a latinas. Por eso hoy tenemos, so today we are here to talk about the history of VAWA and how violence affects Latinas. We have with us today Neusa Gaitán, the Vice President, Senior Vice President of Programs for Mujeres Latinas en Acción. Neusa.
Thank you, Maria, and good morning to all. The Violence Against Women Act, VAWA, recently celebrated its 18th anniversary. It was enacted in 1994 by then Senator Biden and the strong bipartisan support of Congress. The VAWA law increased resources for victims of violence, combining organization at a national level with funding for the state programs and local organizations that primarily work with survivors of violence. Since being enacted, VAWA has played a key role in helping changing social norms by strengthening our national commitment not to look the other way and consider it a private family matter, as it had been for centuries. From the beginning, Congress recognized that immigration status can be used, and it is used, as a tool of abuse and include the VAWA self-petition. This provides critical pathway to safety for immigrant victims who are married to an abusive spouse who is a U.S. citizen or a legal permanent resident when they have refused to petition for their spouse as part of the abuse and control. VAWA is re-examined and reauthorized every 5 to 6 years, allowing legislators to improve upon prior legislation to address gaps and add new provisions that promote the development of a more comprehensive response to violence against women. Reauthorization in 2000 added provision that recognized victims of stalking, dating violence, and included training and resources for elderly and disabled victims of violence. It also made available TNU visas for immigrant women who are victims of certain crimes and assist in the investigation or prosecution of those crimes. During the 2005 reauthorization, VAWA expanded its reach by adding a new section dedicated to improving service for Native American women in Indian country and enhancing protections for immigrant victims, which is critical for the participants our agency serves. It also included several critical new programs, specifically funding services for sexual assault victims, increasing transitional housing support for victims of domestic violence, enhancing prevention effort by engaging men and boys in addressing the needs of teens who are victims of dating violence. It also expanded support for domestic violence and sexual assault services provided by culturally and linguistically specific community-based organizations to improve access to service for victims who face additional barriers. VAWA, it's very important for many of our participants who are victims of violence. At Mujeres, we provide emotional support, information about their rights and options under the law, referrals to resources, and help them to develop a safety plan to keep themselves and any children out of danger. Several of our participants have benefited from VAWA remedies for immigrant victims, which have allowed them to live with dignity, provide a better future for their families, and live free of violence. The bipartisan bill that passed in the Senate helps move VAWA forward. Unfortunately, we cannot say the same thing about the version that was passed in the House of Representatives this year. It leaves out many important improvements that would roll back critical protections for immigrant women. That's why we urge legislators from both sides of the aisle to come together and support a final VAWA bill that protects all victims and does not harm immigrant women and other minority groups at risk. Thank you.
So next with us, we have a story of Irma Duran. Irma Duran.
Buenos días.
Buenos días.
Voy a hablar acerca de mi testimonio. Mi nombre es Irma Duran. Llegué a los Estados Unidos en 1982, dejando atrás una carrera como maestra en Guadalajara, Jalisco, México, para ofrecer una vida mejor a mis hijos y a mi familia. Hace 2 años, conocí a un hombre en un grupo de estudio bíblico que estaba asistiendo. Al principio pensé que era una buena persona y admiraba su devoción y el conocimiento de la Biblia. Cuando se me propuso matrimonio, acepté. Poco después de que nos casamos, me di cuenta de que algo andaba mal con él. Él no me dejaba dormir. Me mantenía despierta hasta tarde. Me obligaba a hacer lo que él quisiera. Él me insultó y me amenazó en una ocasión porque yo le había pedido el divorcio. Y me dijo que por esa negativa y por menos que eso, él me podría con una navaja cortar cada uno de mis ojos. Mi rostro comenzó a brotar una erupción por el estrés de la violencia psicológica. Yo había vivido este tipo de abusos por parte de mi primer marido. Yo sabía que no quería vivir con este abuso feo de nuevo. Así desde que recibí una orden de protección para sacar a mi esposo de mi casa. Ha pasado 1 año. Desde que nos separamos y la orden de restricción está en vigor. Me acerqué a mujeres a través de la recomendación de una amiga y esta organización ha cambiado mi perspectiva de la vida. Yo participé en el grupo de apoyo de violencia doméstica y en el programa de liderazgo para latinas. Cada vez que voy al grupo de apoyo me siento mejor. Gracias a Mujeres Latinas, perdonen. Me siento útil otra vez porque tengo un grupo de personas que me ayuda a tener fuerza y que me apoyan. A través de Mujeres Latinas me enteré de que a causa del abuso que he sufrido yo podría autopetición bajo la ley de violencia contra la mujer, que es el programa VAWA, apliqué y estoy en el proceso de recibir mi estatus legal. Mi vida y mi salud mejoraron marcadamente después de tener la esperanza de este programa. Obtuve la tarjeta médica y finalmente podía ir al médico. He tenido dolor debilitante en mis rodillas durante años, pero con la tarjeta médica pude por fin recibir una terapia física. No podía haber cuidado de mi salud sin la ley VAWA. Ahora soy mucho más feliz y puedo moverme sin ese dolor constante. Una de mis mayores alegrías son mis hijos y mis nietos. Un día me gustaría abrir una guardería para cuidar a los niños cuyas madres trabajan. Tengo la intención de tomar el curso de empresarias, el cual ya lo llevé en Mujeres Latinas, para que pueda estar más preparada para empezar mi propio negocio. También me encantaría ser una maestra como yo cuando estaba en México. Y algún día me gustaría dar clases de alfabetización para niños y para adultos. Estoy muy agradecida por la ley VAWA porque cambió mi vida y me dio oportunidades que nunca imaginaba. Ahora vivo sin violencia y puedo recuperarme completamente de los abusos que he sufrido durante muchos años. Yo exhorto a las autoridades correspondientes que no le quiten este beneficio a las mujeres, tanto VAWA como la Visa U, para que sea una seguridad para ellas en este país. Gracias.
Gracias, Irma. Thank you, Irma, por compartir tu historia. Karina Sazueta también nos presenta. Karina Sazueta will also share her story with us.
Good morning to all. I'm sorry, I'm just... my name is Karina Sazueta. I'm from Mexico City, but I immigrated to the United States to El Paso, Texas in 1993 with my family. I was also victim of domestic violence, but I finally was able to obtain a protective order in 2002, and that also opened the door for me to do other things. I was granted a U visa, which is a derivative from the Great VAWA program. But the reason I was not given a VAWA and I was given a U visa instead is because my ex-husband was not a U.S. citizen nor a permanent resident. So that's the reason I received the U visa, but it was for the same reason, for being a domestic abuse woman. So after that, I was able, after my visa was granted, I was able to attend college. 5 years ago, I started learning English, and this changed my life, the life of my family. And I graduated summa cum laude from the University of Texas at El Paso, and I finally, and thank God, was able to change my status from U visa, and I'm now a permanent resident, and I applied to law school in 2011, and now I'm very happy to say that I'm a second year law student at Indiana Maurer School of Law, and all I have to say is that we really need support. We need our legislators to support this program because this really, really changed the lives of many, many people who are being afraid of not only being deported, but we also deal with the situation of, you know, loss of our children, and there's many, many things. And we need other people to have the same opportunities as we have had. And thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Karina. Her story, as opposed to his story, her story, or their stories, is just one of the many we have seen over the years and exemplifies the critical need for VAWA to continue to protect immigrant victims of domestic violence. Now to talk about the current state of VAWA in Congress and to talk about the findings and recommendations of the report, I am proud to introduce Rosie Hidalgo, Director of Public Policy for Casa de Esperanza, co-author of the report. Para presentarles a Rosie Hidalgo, Directora de Policía Pública para Casa de Esperanza, que es la co-autora de este reporte. Rosie.
Thank you. Good morning. Buenos días. It's an honor and a privilege to be here today, and I really want to commend Mujeres Latinas en Acción on their 40th anniversary and the tremendous work they've been doing in the communities, both locally and nationally. I also want to thank for your courageous testimony, for being here today, and for helping be advocates and speaking out for why we must all continue to unite our efforts to make sure that a very good VAWA bill is reauthorized. And I also want to thank our members of Congress, representatives that are here today, for their tremendous leadership and vision, too, for how our nation needs to be about moving forward in our commitment to end domestic violence, sexual assault, stalking, human trafficking, and dating violence. And that's exactly what VAWA is about. VAWA, as has been mentioned, is a very important and effective piece of legislation, federal legislation, that has had a huge impact on our nation, demonstrating resolve and to come forward and to pass the kinds of laws to set up programs that can work in a coordinated manner. That's one of the hallmarks of VAWA, is a coordinated community response to better train police, prosecutors, the courts, to improve direct services, and to really, as a nation, say, what can we do to knowing that we've made progress, but as Maria said, that a lot more work needs to be done. And that's why every 5 to 6 years, VAWA is reexamined, and there's an opportunity to reauthorize it, to figure out where are the gaps, where do we need to make improvements to keep moving forward. And as has been said, one of the significant pieces of VAWA is that it has always been bipartisan. And that's our message here today, that we need to keep moving forward in a bipartisan manner, not let political rhetoric get in the way of addressing the needs of every victim of domestic violence, regardless of her race, her religion, her immigration status, her sexual orientation, whether she lives on a college campus, whether she lives in public housing, whether she lives in Indian country. In all these different areas, we have recognized that there are needs to improve VAWA so that every victim of domestic violence can have an opportunity, as these courageous survivors have shared with us today, to improve their lives, the lives of their children, and ultimately it's about strengthening our families and strengthening communities when we work together to reduce and prevent domestic violence and sexual assault. And so where are we now? Well, as they mentioned, VAWA was first passed in 1994, and it was reauthorized in 2000 and 2005, each time in a bipartisan manner. And here we are at a point where VAWA has expired. It expired in 2011. Two different versions of VAWA were passed in the House and in the Senate, but they have been deadlocked and have not been able to secure final passage of a VAWA bill that will move us forward in providing protections for all victims. And so that's why this is a timely opportunity on Domestic Violence Awareness Month. It's a timely opportunity to send a message to our representatives that after these elections, we want Congress to come back and work together to prove, to reauthorize VAWA in a manner that protects all victims and that does not take us backwards in the protections that are already in place. And I do want to highlight, as some of the previous speakers have said, that some of the protections in VAWA were targeted towards immigrant victims, recognizing their tremendous vulnerability to be exploited, and to make sure that they too have a pathway to be able to seek safety, to come out of the shadows, as well as to be able to hold all perpetrators accountable. So when Congress first passed VAWA in 1994, the VAWA self-petition that Irma referenced was included in there, because Congress realized that sometimes immigration status becomes a tool of abuse. When a woman is married to someone who's a U.S. citizen and lawful permanent resident who could petition for her but chooses not to, why? What more powerful tool of power and control than to keep someone afraid, fearful that if they call the police, they'll be deported, fearful that they may lose custody of their children, unable to go out and work, to get affordable housing. And Congress said, no, we must make sure then that there is a way that a person who's a victim of abuse, married to someone in that situation, can self-petition. And that is a critical remedy. But in 2000, as has been alluded to, a different remedy was also added, because when VAWA was being reauthorized, they said, okay, we also recognize that there are some whose abuser is not a U.S. citizen, legal permanent resident, or that someone they're not married to. It could be a stranger. And Congress recognized that the U visa then would be an important remedy to help those victims of crime come forward. And in order to get a U visa, that person has to be willing to cooperate in the investigation and prosecution of a crime and receive law enforcement certification to that effect. And so this VAWA report that is being put out today demonstrates the history, the commitment of VAWA to move forward. In there, you'll see there's a story, for example, of a woman, Victoria, a married mother of four children, 27 years old. One night, two strangers broke into her home looking for money. They didn't find money, but they sexually assaulted Victoria. Because of her immigration status, she was very fearful. She was in need of services, but was very fearful to call the police. But luckily, she was encouraged to come forward, and through the U visa was told that if she assisted in the investigation and prosecution of that crime, she could apply for a U visa to help her not be afraid to come out of the shadows, not be afraid to seek help, and she did. And so Victoria, through her coming forward, was able to assist, and these two men were caught. They were arrested, they were charged, and were convicted of aggravated sexual assault. And so we need to realize that the U visa is important for the victims, for the stability of their families, but also for our society at large. All perpetrators need to be held accountable. Victims need to come out of the shadows, otherwise those kinds of crimes continue, and there's a vulnerable class that can be exploited. And today Victoria is doing well, as are her four children. And she was able, through the U visa, also to get her lawful permanent residency status, go back to school and work and move her family forward. So, unfortunately, one of the roadblocks right now to finishing a good VAWA bill are those who want to go backwards on the protections for immigrant victims. And I think we all need to stand up together and say no, that our nation is committed to protecting all victims. And when we were moving forward, ideas and addressing the gaps, the National Task Force to End Sexual and Domestic Violence, of which Casa de Esperanza is a member of that steering committee, we worked for over 2 years, hundreds of organizations from all over the country, gathering the input of thousands of individuals, of law enforcement, of the courts, of advocates, of medical professionals, of survivors. How can VAWA be improved? And I want to tell you, the bill that passed in the Senate, S-1925, is a bipartisan bill. It was introduced in a bipartisan manner by Senator Leahy, Democrat of Vermont, and Senator Crapo, Republican of Idaho. It had 61 co-sponsors, original co-sponsors, Democrats and Republicans, and I want to give a shout out to Senator Kirk here of Illinois, Republican, who also was involved in the negotiations to draft a good bipartisan VAWA bill. And that bill included a recognition of the need to increase the number of U visas. Presently, there's only 10,000 U visas given out a year for a selected category of crimes that include domestic violence and sexual assault. And that cap has been met the past 3 years. And so Congress recognized, and in fact, law enforcement and the Department of Homeland Security came forward and said it would benefit public safety and accountability to increase that cap on the number of U visas. The original proposal was to increase it to 20,000, but through negotiations with the Republicans, it was reduced to 15,000 a year. So just a modest increase of 5,000 to help law enforcement be able to use this tool. And it was increased in a manner that would recapture previously unused visas, because even though the U visa was put in place in 2000, it took till 2007 before the regulations were in place, before this really became available. So it was a compromise. It's a modest increase, recognizing that this is an important tool to reduce violence. And there are a few other modest improvements on the protections for immigrant victims. No new remedies were created, merely addressing some gaps. And so here we stand, unfortunately, the House bill omitted this increase, but not only that, has omitted protections, important protections for Native American victims of domestic violence, has omitted provisions to increase and improve access to services for LGBT victims, for important protections on campuses. And so we are concerned about that. And the House bill also actually seeks to roll back current protections for immigrant victims. There are things put in place there that would weaken confidentiality protections, that would create new barriers, that would remove a pathway to lawful permanent residency for victims who receive the U visa, who need that for stability and to seek services and to help their families. And so we are proud to stand, nonetheless, here working with members of Congress to see how we can get a good bill finalized and passed. Congresswoman Judy Biggert, who's a Republican here from Illinois, as you know, has been part of that effort to say, let's work together. Let's make sure we don't leave out important protections. Let's make sure we get a good bill. Congressman Mike Quigley has also been key in that respect. And so we look forward. Our challenge, our commitment is to, let's not just work for social services improvements. Let's work for social change. Let's all of us recommit this October, Domestic Violence Awareness Month, to doing what all of us can do to reduce and prevent violence, and to also make sure that Congress passes a very strong VAWA that seeks to protect all victims of domestic violence, and that certainly does not go backward, does not roll back any critical protections. VAWA is about moving forward, and our nation's commitment is about moving forward to reduce and end domestic violence. Thank you.
Gracias, Rosie. Thank you, Rosie. And as Rosie pointed out, Congress should work in a bipartisan manner to make sure that a final VAWA bill passes this year that enhances protections for all victims and does not harm current protections for immigrant victims. Our next speaker has been a champion on women issues and has stressed the importance of VAWA since its inception. Here with us today, Congresswoman Judy Biggert, to share her experiences with VAWA.
Thank you. Thank you, Maria, and thanks to all these terrific organizations for your work on this report and for your great public service to the communities. And I'm honored to be here today with you just because of the many heroes who serve on the front lines in the fight against domestic violence. I really have worked with those in my community. I represent the 13th District of Illinois, and it's the southwest suburbs, and what we have spent a lot of time, I always go out to the providers, who are the ones that are gonna have to do what these bills say, and how is that gonna work? But you're here, and we're all here, because we wanna put an end to domestic violence, and we all want to ensure that every victim, including immigrants, can get the help that they need. As you know, one of the fundamental tools for serving victims is in legislative limbo, as you've heard quite a bit about it, but the Violence Against Women's Act, or VAWA, expired in September of 2011. And for the last year, I've really been working hard to pry the bill from the grip of partisan gridlock. As part of that effort, I've been meeting with victims service organizations in my district to really discuss what works and what doesn't work. What I've heard time and time again is that domestic violence can happen at any time, to anyone, and anywhere. It's a senseless crime that pays no attention to age, race, ethnicity, or sexual orientation. And as your report reveals, one in four Latinas will experience domestic violence in her lifetime, which is in line with the national average overall. But sadly, this has not been fixed, and we need to do it right away. And so what I did was to do my own bill. after meeting with these various groups. And it really is a companion to the Senate measure. And this was well before the House took up FAWA. I got really worried that it was now long overdue. Unfortunately, my vote wasn't voted on. My bill wasn't voted on. The House didn't bring it forward out after I'd introduced it. So despite my best efforts to help to educate all the members of my own party, the House passed a bill back in May that failed to adequately protect all victims of violence. So I voted against it. And since then, I've been calling on House leaders to proceed to look at the procedural hurdles and adopt the Senate endorsed provisions that would protect all victims of violence. I was pleased that Speaker Boehner did pick a conference committee. That's what we do when the bills are different. The House bill differs from the Senate bill, so there's a conference committee of members who get together and try and get the language all together so that it can go to the President to be signed. Well, that's happened, but we haven't seen anything yet, so I hope that we will be able to do something in the lame duck. So now what's happened is we've got that committee picked, but the Senate still hasn't been able to do anything when there's kind of a hurdle that has to be remedied, and we could call it the blue step. And I know that I'm going to leave to Clotito to Clotisol to sorry to look at that and tell you about it when she speaks. I mean, we really need to address the issue that we can get back together. And as we've been talking about, there's a hurdle there, but with all of us working together, we can get beyond that and get this bill adopted. As anyone who has worked on VAWA reauthorization in 2000 and 2005, I can tell you that this has never happened before. It's always been a bipartisan bill, and I've always been on it. And it was very disturbing to me that this would happen and not be able to get this out. But we can't settle for a bill that rolls back the progress we made in learning how to protect victims. We need a strong, robust VAWA bill that will give every victim the safety and security to escape violence, and that means several things. First, that we need a bill that ensures that immigrant victims aren't deported simply for reporting a crime, and they'll be able to get these visas. Second, we need a VAWA bill that provides equal protection for LGBT individuals. And third, we need a VAWA bill that bolsters enforcement on Native American reservations. And lastly, we need a bill that increases the transparency and prevention programs on college campuses. That's what was in my bill, and that's what's in the Senate bill, and that's what we're fighting for today. As I mentioned, the service providers in my district have shared with me the same stories that you've heard today, and these are not isolated incidents. Too often, you know, Latinas don't report the abuse out of fear of deportation and what else can happen, and abusers use that to intimidate and control the victim. And whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, I think that everyone can agree that our policy should put victims first and get the abusers and criminals off the street. That's what our VAWA bill should be about. We can't allow these life-saving programs to languish. And I applaud you for all that you do to serve the victims of domestic violence in the Latino community. And rest assured that I won't give up on the VAWA bill. And together we will make sure that the immigrant victims can come out of the darkness of violence and get the help that they deserve. So thank you very much for inviting me here.
Thank you, Representative Biggert. Muchísimas gracias. We are very, very grateful for your support and your bipartisan work to protect women's rights. We are also thankful for the support of Congressman Mike Quigley. Congressman Mike.
Good morning. I want to recognize Ms. Teo. She's with Senator Durbin's office. He's also been a tremendous advocate for renewing VAWA in the appropriate way. I want to give special thanks to Mujeres Latinas en Acción and Casa de Esperanza for their outstanding leadership and advocacy on this essential issue. They put together an excellent report. I hope you've made 435 copies for the House and 100 copies for the United States Senate. Make them readily available. I don't need to rehash what's been already said on this issue. Domestic violence affects the lives of 1 in 4 women, and immigrant Latinas who face even greater barriers than other groups experience violence at even higher rates. And as been said, what's disturbing here is this. VAWA was passed on a bipartisan basis. Every time it was renewed, it was done on a bipartisan basis. And every time it was renewed, times change. People evolve. They understand more. Reports like this breed understanding. So more groups were included. And I serve on the Judiciary Committee. So this is where VAWA played out on the House side. There were attempts, as Ms. Biggert alluded to make the House bill more in line with a better Senate bill. I was the sponsor of many of those amendments. They failed, particularly ones that helped LGBT victims, immigrant victims, and victims who are North American, North American Indians, Native Americans. This was as frustrating a session and as frustrating a time in the 112th Congress as I have experienced. It is unacceptable. What's lost upon the argument made in opposition was that everyone deserves access to protection, safety, and justice. We're going backwards, as been stated. So we have to remember that this version that was passed on the House side would also make U visas temporary, thereby discouraging victims from coming forward to report crimes due to fear of eventual deportation. It would allow immigration officials to interview abusers, removing confidentiality protections that shield victims from retributions from their abusers. It's unacceptable, especially in this day and age. I'd like to think that this country always evolves toward greater justice and protection for all. Dr. King said the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. Well, we're not bending that arc in the 112th Congress. And I know this is more to you than just a bill or a page with words on it. It affects everything you do. And I want to thank you for what you do, because we go to Congress and we deal with a lot of different issues. You're fighting on this issue every single day. It means a lot to me as well. My first job in the city of Chicago, I was still in high school, I spent a summer at the Salvation Army Lodge for Battered Women. It used to be on Wisconsin Street. Now, we all know what people in the suburbs grew up thinking about this. This was perhaps, what, an urban issue, or it didn't happen in my neighborhood, right? Well, it was a painful lesson to be learned for me then and for our country as time goes on. But we've learned other lessons about domestic violence. And the only way we're going to solve this issue is to continue to learn and solve these problems on a bipartisan basis. And we go backwards. We do our country and our justice system an extraordinary disservice. So I'd like to think that people take this into consideration and they watch what happened in the Judiciary Committee on the House floor, and then we'll come back after November and get the important things done that our country needs. But first and foremost, with all the critical issues we're addressing, think about this. It all begins at home, and everyone should feel safe in their own homes. And they shouldn't have their country and their system of justice betraying them. So I, again, want to thank you for the work you do on a day-to-day basis and for this essential report. I'd like to think it would be mandatory reading for my colleagues. Thank you.
Yes, Congressman, we will definitely make them available to 435 copies, and we plan on being in D.C. in February with the same study. So thank you very much. We're also very grateful to the continuous support from Senator Dick Durbin and from his office. We have with us his Chicago Chief of Staff, Clarisol Duque. Clarisol.
Thank you, Maria. It's a real honor to be here this morning on behalf of Senator Durbin. I want to first thank Congressman Mike Quigley, Congresswoman Judy Biggert for their incredible fight on behalf of women of all walks of life. Maria, it is, I think, quite fitting that you have chosen the Maria Mangual Leadership Conference to release this report. A few years back, Senator Durbin, while visiting Mujeres Latinas en Acción, had the opportunity to personally hear Maria's story. He was so incredibly moved. And there is no doubt that it is Maria Mangual's courage and tenacity on behalf of this issue and all women that had led us to the passage of VAWA in 1994. And there's also no doubt that since 1994, the progress that we've made has been absolutely tremendous. However, we know that we need to pass the reauthorization of VAWA because there are so many women who urgently need this to happen. It is, the numbers are staggering, and again, while we've seen progress, we all know someone who has gone through this personally. We owe it to our mothers, our daughters, our sisters, our girlfriends to make sure that VAWA is reauthorized this year. Senator Durbin is completely committed to making this happen. We were very pleased to see that the Senate bill was such a bipartisan bill, but I do believe we need to come together and get this done as soon as possible. I'll say a few words in Spanish. Esta mañana estoy muy contenta de estar aquí representando a la oficina y al senador Richard Durbin. El senador ha trabajado bastante en favor de la reautorización del bill para la violencia contra la mujer. Sabemos que desde 1994, cuando pasó esta legislación, hemos hecho bastante progreso. Hemos llegado a un punto que debemos de sentirnos orgullosos, pero desafortunadamente no, nuestro trabajo no ha terminado, no ha culminado. Y sabemos que en este momento hay bastantes mujeres que necesitan que esta legislación continúe. Sabemos que le debemos a nuestras madres, a nuestras hijas, a nuestras hermanas y nuestras amigas, necesitamos continuar a pelear para que esta legislación se reautorice. Muchas gracias. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Clarisol. We are grateful for Senator Durbin's work on assuring that immigrant women receive the same protections as other victims of violence. To showcase the issue of violence against women, we have a powerful presentation of photos that Dr. Silvia Chavez Baray from the University of El Paso, Texas, will speak about regarding violence against women on the border. This is also very symbolic. Maria Mangual was from El Paso, and sometimes I believe there are no coincidences in life. Dr. Chavez Baray.
Well, thank you so much. My first language is Spanish. They told me I just have 2 minutes, so I will speak in Spanish because I do it faster. So, okay. Bueno. Nosotros en realidad estamos trabajando con muchas organizaciones. Es una investigación acerca de violencia doméstica que está patrocinando UTEP y trabajamos con dos grupos. Uno de servicios diocesanos para migrantes y refugiados, el cual le brinda el servicio legal, la regularización del estatus migratorio, y otro que es Familias Triunfadoras, que es una C que solamente les apoya. Y tuvimos varias agencias que nos están apoyando con esta investigación. Trabajamos con 25 mujeres, 3 se retiraron en el camino porque encontraron trabajo, gracias, verdad, a Dios, y terminamos la investigación con 22. El trabajo de fotovoces, les dimos cámaras, tomaron fotografías de lo que significaba para ellos la violencia doméstica y escribían las historias. Ellas hacían una votación y escogieron las mejores fotografías que las representaron. Entonces, traje algunas de sus voces e imágenes de lo que ellas quieren que se muestre, quieren que se haga público, y un llamado a la acción que ellas escribieron. La primera fotografía es de María y se llama I Like You. Y habla de cómo ella, igual que muchas mujeres, han sufrido violencia doméstica en todos los aspectos. Les invito, cuando terminemos, que se acerquen, están en inglés y en español. El tercer FOMI que les puse, panel, habla del círculo de la violencia y algo bien importante que no han incluido, ya empezaron a incluir, pero quitan el privilegio masculino, es cómo parte de que la mujer pierda control y poder es no tener su estatus migratorio adecuado. ¿Por qué? Porque la mujer no habla por miedo a la deportación, por miedo a perder a los hijos, por miedo al idioma, por las barreras que se encuentra. Curiosamente encontramos que dentro de este grupo teníamos dentistas, teníamos ingenieros, tenemos contadoras, tenemos ingenieros, dentistas, contadoras, una fisioterapeuta, un nutrióloga, y entonces decimos, bueno, esto es de todas las clases, se da en todos los niveles y se tiene que atender porque afecta a los niños. Luego decimos que los niños son el futuro, pero la mamá es quien educa a los niños, y mientras esté dañado esa parte, los niños van a estar dañados. Y entonces nos encontramos con la de rompiendo el ciclo donde están los niños jugando. Esa foto la tomó una señora que vive en su refugio y dice en este albergue, dice, yo veo a los niños como en el juego representan la violencia. Y aunque ya no están viviendo ahí, tenemos que trabajar con esto. Tenemos otra foto de María. María le tomó la fotografía a su hermana y dice, ella es Rosa, sufrió violencia igual que yo. Pero ella todavía no se ha podido salir por medio a su estatus migratorio y ahorita tiene parálisis facial del estrés que esto le genera. ¿Sí? Y ella solicita precisamente apoyo de VAWA para que su hermana no tenga que andar mendigando dólares, así pone. ¿Sí? Tenemos la foto de querida abuelita, donde la abuelita, que no tiene su estatus migratorio regularizado, cuida a sus dos nietos porque su hija murió por violencia doméstica. Tenemos la foto de Lourdes, donde ella se siente como agua sucia, ¿sí? Porque su marido ejercía violencia sexual con ella y así se sentía. Y tenemos la foto de Norma, que ella dice el escape. Ella se sentía, ella es ingeniero, ella dice, yo me sentía como un papel de baño y que en ocasiones lo que quería era tirar el papel y bajarle. Y esto habla de suicidio. Encontramos en ellas encontramos evidencia de depresión. Todas que alguna vez tuvieron ideación suicida. Y de los dos grupos encontramos algo bien importante. El 100% de la población de servicios diocesanos para migrantes y refugiados ya tiene su visa de trabajo o ya tienen su visa VAWA. Ellas trabajan, ellas ya viven solas, ya están fuera de un albergue, tienen dos trabajos, están siendo productivas. Yo le comentaba, les comentaba que cuando reciben su permiso de trabajo salen como caballos desbocados a trabajar y a sacar su familia adelante, ¿sí? Y el otro grupo, el de familias triunfadoras, tuvimos que ir a trabajar a San Elizario, una población que se encuentra a una hora y media del paso, porque tenían miedo incluso de salir de su casa, tenían miedo de las redadas. ¿Sí? Y sus hijos pequeños son los que hacen el ir al mandado, el ir a vender la comida. Entonces es importante que los tomadores de decisión, que los políticos, que nosotros los académicos nos apoyamos, nos unamos, aunque estemos en diferentes estados, y trabajemos en pro de la ley y en apoyo de esa situación que toma miles de vidas de mujeres y afecta, a todos nos afecta de una u otra manera. Todos hemos estado cerca de la violencia doméstica de una o de otra manera y mientras estemos en comunidad, de una o de otra manera nos va a seguir afectando. Gracias.
Thank you, Dr. Silvia Chavez-Baray, for putting together such a powerful and compelling project that shows again why we need to strengthen our commitment to end violence against women and reauthorize VAWA. Now, I want to introduce a champion on issues that affect Latina women and women and their families. I am proud to welcome
Thank you very much, María. I want to say a few words in Spanish first also. Bueno, primeramente quiero darle las gracias a Mujeres en Salud. Dolores Huerta, Fundación para Organizar Comunidades. También nosotros, nosotros entrenamos a las mujeres para que ellas puedan ayudar a todas sus compañeras en lo que es la violencia doméstica, ¿no? Tenemos clases para ellos, para que ellas puedan ser maestras también. Pero también quiero dar las gracias a los medios de comunicación que están aquí y que se esperaron, porque yo pienso que ustedes pueden ayudar bastante a dar este mensaje. Primeramente a las mujeres, que no tengan miedo, que aquí tienen ayuda con Mujeres en Acción y Casa de Esperanza y los otros grupos aquí que ayudan. Y también un mensaje a los hombres también, para decirles que ellos pueden perjudicar su estatus de migración. Si no son ciudadanos y son residentes, pueden perjudicar su estatus de migración si ellos usan violencia doméstica en contra de las mujeres. Y cuando digo eso, digo al mismo tiempo que muchas mujeres, porque saben que eso existe, se detienen. Y no vienen y no dicen lo que está pasando con ellas. Así es que tenemos que decirles que aquí pueden venir para ayuda con Mujeres en Acción. Y también que todos podemos escribirle a nuestros congresistas. Aquí tenemos dos congresistas, republicana y demócrata, que están en favor. Pero sabemos que lo que tiene detenido ahorita la ley, para que no sea mejor, que la tienen detenido, porque tenemos algunos congresistas que no quieren pasar esta ley. Así es que si son de distritos afuera de estos dos congresistas, hay que avisar. Sale por teléfono, por carta, por email, por visita personal a los oficinas de esos congresistas diciéndole, tienen que pasar esta ley. Ya basta que están en una guerra en contra de nuestras mujeres, ¿no? Ya basta y queremos que ustedes pasen esta ley porque para las mujeres que más lo necesitan. So I just want to thank Mujeres en Acción. I want to thank Casa Esperanza for the wonderful report that you've made, but also for all of the help that you're giving women, because they do need the full support when they find themselves in this kind of a situation. I also want to thank the media that's here and that has stayed here, because we know that we can get this message out to the community to let women know that there is help, that there are places here with Mujeres en Acción, Casa Esperanza, and other women's organizations that will assist them, because we know when you are this kind of a victim, you need a lot of support, not only for yourself, but also for your children. And also, the media can also get the message out to men out there, especially those men who have an immigrant status or have residency, that you are putting in jeopardy your residency in the United States if you attack the women in your life, you know, if you are a perpetrator of violence. In my own organization, the Dolores Huerta Foundation for Community Organizing, we do domestic violence training. We actually train women to be peer educators of the women in our community so that women will know what they have to do. And of course, we know we have two Congress people here, one Republican, Judy, and of course, one Democrat. And but we know that there are other Congress people out there that are holding this law back. And so if you do not live in their districts, but you live in another congressional district, and tell your friends and everybody, you know, we have an election coming up on November the 5th, very important. You know, email them, call them on the telephone, go visit them in their offices and say, you've got to pass this law. This is so important. It's for our most vulnerable women, and we're sick and tired of this war against women, right? We're sick and tired of this war against women, and here you're attacking the most vulnerable women in our society, and we need to pass this law. We've got to get in that conference committee, that they've got to make the law that comes out of there be more like the Senate bill, right? And like Judy's bill, okay, to make sure that we get a good law that protects all of our women, and then we can go forward instead of backward. Si se puede. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Dolores. I do want to mention the photo exhibit will be up during this press conference, but we will also have it around our the other table booths of demonstration, so that people do get a chance, not just at this press conference, but all of our participants at our conference have an opportunity to view the voices and the words of survivors, and so we can continue this effort. So this does conclude our press conference today, and we are now open to questions specific to this topic.
We need more Republicans to continue to work to get
that. Thank you.
Any other questions? If we do not, We will be open to one-on-one interviews. Dolores Huerta has agreed to answer questions for media as well. So please do so in an orderly manner. And thank you. Thank you all for your attendance on this issue. We will please be sure to also visit our webpage, our newly designed webpage, Mujeres Latinas en Acción. There you can not only look at the report, but you can also help us distribute it. Okay, MujeresLatinasenAccion.org. Very easy. So thank you very much, and we'll be open for the one-on-one interviews. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And likewise, wonderful. Great. Yeah. A lot of conference calls where we've been talking with your staff, but really appreciate all your support. Like I said, I am confident, even in this blue slip issue, on that, there's a way around it.
It's too bad that it's anything like that. I mean, that makes this.